Good morning. I call this meeting of the House Finance Committee to order. We have several bills to consider. With the budget season coming up in the month of June, we have several bills that may be part of the budget negotiations. And so we're going to be voting on five different bills this morning, and I'm going to be asking for a re-referral. Can I have our committee legislative assistant, Lori Smith, call the roll? Here. She's on her way. On his way. McNeil is a vote by designation. A vote by designation. We'll be doing vote by designation.
Here. By designation. By designation. By designation.
Here.
Thank you. And as I said, we have a couple that are on their way, and I'll announce when they arrive. So the first item of business we had a bill that was referred to our committee, Representative Hanbidge and Representative Cephas. It's House Bill 975. The Children and Youth Committee has had a hearing on child care issues, including the public-private partnership that's mentioned in this bill. There is a tax credit in the bill, a 50% tax credit for businesses, but the prime sponsors have asked that this be referred to the Children and Youth Committee. The bill has many other aspects besides the business tax credit. Do I have a motion to re-refer the bill to the Children and Youth Committee? Moved by Representative Fiedler, seconded by Representative Deloso. Is there any discussion on the bill or the re-referral? I'll call the roll. Are there any negative votes on re-referring House Bill 975 to Children and Youth? Unanimous. Next, I'd like to call up one of the bills that I'm going out of order here. Call up one of the bills we talked about yesterday. Representative Gallagher and Representative Greiner had the bill about the 529 program. It's House Bill 1267. I will call on our research analyst, Shannon Snell, for a bill summary.
Thank you. House Bill 1267 updates the Tuition Account Programs and College Savings Bond Act, commonly known as the TAP Act, to align with federal changes, and it also transfers the Keystone Scholars Grant Program language from the fiscal code into the TAP Act.
Thank you. Do I have a motion to bring up House Bill 1259? Representative Greiner, second by Representative Gallagher. I told you that was the dream team. So we appreciate the discussion we had yesterday at our public hearing, where Representative Gallagher and Greiner and our state treasurer, Stacey Garrity, testified. Is there any other discussion on House Bill 1259? I'm sorry. 1267. The motion by Representative Gallagher and Greiner would be for House Bill 1267. I think I said the wrong number. All right. I'm partially right. There you go. Any discussion on House Bill 1267? Are there any negative votes on House Bill 1267? Thank you. Passed unanimously. The next bill to consider today is House Bill 1138, introduced by Representative Waxman and myself. I'll call on Shannon Snell, our research analyst, to give a summary of House Bill 1138 regarding the cell phone tax.
House Bill 1138 eliminates the sales and use tax and gross receipts tax on mobile telecommunication services.
Thank you, Chairman. House Bill 1138, as said, eliminates the sales and gross receipts on telecommunications.
Representative Waxman, let me pause you for 1 minute. I need a motion to bring up the bill. Representative Fiedler, Representative Gallagher, second. Representative Waxman, I'll call on the prime sponsor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As stated, you know, this is part of Governor Shapiro's budget proposal. It is, I think, a recognition that these services are essential services in today's modern world. And I would ask respectfully for a yes vote from our committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Waxman. And I will note that we did get, I think, the governor in his budget speech back in March talked about an annualized number of about $124 million. And we did get a statement from the Department of Revenue saying that this would take effect January 1st of 2024 if it's adopted, and the savings for the 6 months of this fiscal year would be $62 million, half of the 124. And then it also has savings projected out 5 years. And Representative Kenyatta and Representative Cepeda Freitas are here. We voted you by designation on the first two unanimous votes. Is there any other discussion on House Bill 1138? Representative Jack Rader from Monroe County.
Wow, you know where I'm from. Thank you. My concern on the package of bills, actually, is I don't know where we are in the budget yet. And not knowing how our revenue is going to pan out and our expenses, I realize everyone thinks that we have plenty of money for this year, and we probably do. But my concern is years down the line. So this says, you know, normally $120-some million in future years, that's a lot of money. And how are we going to make that up in the budget? And it's not just this bill. You know, each of these bills takes a lot of money out of revenue. So I'm concerned about those, and I would like to have some kind of guesstimate on how we would replace that money from our revenue. So it's great to save money for consumers. I'm all for that. I like that idea. But I also want to have enough money in the budget that we don't have to raise taxes and everybody or do something that we don't want to do. And I'm not assured by that right now. So for me, I would like to see how our budget plays out, and maybe it is in the budget, and then pass something afterwards that we know it's covered, not just for this year, but for future years. I think we have to think about the future also. So that's my concern about this bill and also about all the bills, actually, today. I don't know where we're going to get the money in future years. I realize this year we do know where we're going to get the money, but not in future years, and I'm concerned about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Rader. Are there any other comments on House Bill 1138? Okay. Representative Mercury.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would just like to echo Mr. Rader's comments and perhaps pose the question to the majority party as to the nature of this budget cycle and where we do plan to increase revenues in order to pass this package of tax relief and fee relief, which is quite substantial. And I know we're just starting the process, and if that's the answer, that's okay. But I think it would be worth discussion in this committee to know where we do plan to raise the revenue. Thanks.
Anybody else would like to speak? Representative Waxman?
Just to respond directly to the question, I appreciate it. I am a first-term member. It is my understanding that the state budget is a mixture of both revenue and, you know, and taxes that are then used for spending priorities. And as part of this budget process, we will decide what the mixture of taxes, fees, revenue adjustments should be. My understanding is that's what happens every single budget cycle. And so I would assume that if this, you know, were to make it out of committee and then, you know, make it on the floor, that it would be a part of that conversation of how do we decide what we're going to pay for and where both on the spending side and on the tax side. Now, if it doesn't work that way, perhaps someone can correct me. The second thing that I would say is that, kind of on the logic, if I'm trying to follow it, is that anything that impacts the state budget, nothing should be done until the negotiation is over. I mean, how do you have any conversation about any tax item, any revenue item, any new spending, investments, expanding or reducing any program under constraints that we can't do anything until we know where we are in the budget process? So I don't quite understand that. I think that this is a responsible thing to move forward, and I hope my colleagues will join me in voting yes. Thank you.
And Representative Malcolm Kenyatta.
Thank you, Chairman. I think what the budget that House Democrats just voted on yesterday is not only responsible, but actually we're not talking about raising taxes. And right now what we're saying is that we should actually save taxpayers even more money on a fee that is, in my opinion, a fee that we could do without. And so I would hope that everybody in this committee would be for lowering the tax burden on the citizens of Pennsylvania. That's what our budget does. But what it also does is responsibly invest in the people of Pennsylvania, understanding that we have a rainy day fund that I and others voted to make sure was robust, that we're going to continue to think about the future. But we also can't say, well, maybe in some future time, we'll have a different economic picture than we have right now, so we shouldn't be cutting fees for hardworking Pennsylvanians. That doesn't make a lot of sense to me. We have done a reasonable, balanced, thoughtful, we've taken a reasonable, balanced, thoughtful approach to the budget, looking at the fact that tax revenue has come in significantly higher than folks would have thought, that the financial picture right now in Pennsylvania is one that is being managed with a thoughtfulness from the majority party, and that we're going to continue to be in the business of lowering fees for hardworking Pennsylvanians, that we're going to continue to be in the business of being good stewards of the dollars that we have, and that we can do this in a responsible way. And I think this is a responsible proposal. It's a common sense proposal, in my opinion, and I'm going to look forward to voting for it. And I hope that everybody this morning would vote to lower fees for hardworking Pennsylvanians, because that's what this is about.
Thank you. Representative Chair Greiner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was curious, could the maker of the bill tell me how much savings this would be per individual, a normal individual, just, one person, normal individual, how much we're talking per month savings overall?
Thank you so much for your question. And it really, really depends on the level of service that an individual, purchases, for services in terms of the impact. So it varies from household to household. Obviously, a single person who has one phone and they're paying for one plan, versus a household that has four or five phones, maybe multiple tablets, digital devices, obviously the impact, it depends on very much about how many devices there are in a household, so it can vary greatly. But as you know, the calculation is based on the percentage of both the sales and the gross receipts, and that's listed in the bill. So, you should be able to very easily, anyone can take their own, monthly bill that they pay and calculate what this impact would be for them. That's one of the things that I think is really great about this particular tax cut, is that it goes directly to consumers in a way, taxpayers, in a way that they can understand, that they can calculate themselves, to the chairman's point and question about the impact. Quite frankly, what kind of used to pass for tax policy in this building, it was often very difficult for the average person to figure out where the savings were. And in this bill, because they went to special interests that were in the room, but, those cuts weren't made, generally made known to the public. This puts it right in people's hands to figure out, to calculate what the chair is asking about the impact of them. It's very easy to do, and that's why I think that it's such a good proposal, because, our you know, our constituents, our residents here in the state will be able to themselves see directly the impact in their own pocketbook and then make their own judgment about whether it matters or not.
We have a lot of bills coming up where I do question the accounting inside the bills themselves, but with this one, like for myself personally, I'm thinking it's $4 a month, something like that for that for my savings. And I guess that's real savings, I guess. But this goes back to my colleague from Allegheny County. I mean, we have a lot of bills here, and significant amount of dollars we're talking coming out of the general fund. And yeah, it's fine this year when we have a surplus, but it's pretty obvious moving forward we're not going to have one. And in addition, the Department of Revenue also indicated that the savings weren't going to be $120 million either. We have a number much less than that in our savings. And I did want to ask that, too, in the data that was provided.
The data that we got, the governor said $124 million on an annualized basis. The Department of Revenue sent us something that said 62, exactly half of 124, because they're talking about implementing this on January 1st, halfway through our tax year. So for this year, it was $62 million, and they have annual numbers. I think it was 89 in the second year, and they did give a projection. But $62 million. I do agree with the chair's number on an average family might be saving $4 a month times 12 months. That's $48, $50 a year. The governor said there's 10 million people who have cell phones in Pennsylvania. And here we have the state of Pennsylvania. When you pay your cell phone bill, the state of Pennsylvania is taking a dollar here, a dollar there. Why is the state of Pennsylvania taking that when we have billions of dollars in our current fund? Let me just want to answer the question I got before on how we're going to pay for this. So we did pass a budget bill yesterday. The governor put out his budget in March. We passed the House version of the budget yesterday. On the balance sheet, I'm not talking about the $5 billion in the rainy day fund. That's the most ever. In the Great Recession about 15 years ago, we had $750 million in the rainy day fund. Now we're at $5 billion, and we are sustaining that this year, next year, and for years beyond. But not counting that $5 billion, you look at the balance sheet, and there's about $50 billion available, $45 billion proposed to be spent, a leftover fund balance at the end of the year, which would be June of next year, $5.5 billion. So $5 billion in the rainy day fund, $5.5 billion available in the current. What are we talking about here? We're talking about $64 million, 1.1%, just a fraction of what's available. And this is a tax cut that would benefit 10 million people who have cell phones. Obviously, family of four, they would see, you know, that savings on each of their cell phones. So I realize this is one piece of the budget negotiations we are proposing. Why not? Let's start by cutting taxes. Let's start by having a tax cut that would benefit 10 million people across Pennsylvania. And that's why I'm encouraging a yes vote, and that's why I'm a co-sponsor with Representative Waxman.
I guess just in my concluding remarks, I understand the makers, the maker of the bill and the impact, you know, that it would have on the individuals. I do think, though, and maybe it's just because of my background, I do think we need to look at this from a macro perspective, and I am going to be a no on this bill out of committee moving forward. I think in the context of all these bills, according to my colleague from Monroe County, I think he made an excellent point, and we're gonna probably, I guess there's going to be more discussion on these other bills, too, even more in depth, I believe, concerning some of the issues concerning the accounting behind this. But I understand the intent, but I think under a macro perspective that I'm going to be a no on this bill.
I think Representative Rader has another comment.
Yeah, it's just a follow-up comment. I don't know if it's necessary or not. I am for tax cuts. I love tax cuts. But it has to be a big picture for me, and what I see here we're taking a lot of money out of revenue stream with multiple bills, and I'm just afraid of that. Once you're, and you're right. Right now, I think we have plenty of money this year. Future years, we can discuss where we go with that, because I think it depends on what our budgets say. So I'm a businessman at heart. I'm not a politician, and I try and plan for the future. I'm a little concerned when we take so many revenue streams out of our budget. It's $5 for a person or $4 or whatever, but I'm concerned about future years. I'm not just voting in this year. I'm thinking about the future, and that does concern me. Thank you.
I think Representative Kenyatta.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to make a couple of points for the record. So today, Democrats are going to vote to cut taxes, and it sounds like a lot of my colleagues are going to vote to not cut taxes. So I don't know. That's interesting, but that should be highlighted for the record. I would also say, when people talk about what the savings are, you know, I think the problem in this building too often is that there are not enough people who come from poor and working class families like mine who understand that whether it's $5 or $10 or $50, you know, you didn't meet my mama, Kelly Kenyatta. She'd take $4 and feed 6 kids and figure out a way to do it. And so every time we have an opportunity to cut the costs for hardworking Pennsylvanians, we will do it. And I've been on this committee for a number of years, Mr. Chairman, and I would make the point that when it's time to cut taxes for big institutions that have a bunch of lobbyists running around this building, we never hear the same concern that we're hearing highlighted today about where we're gonna get the money, how are we gonna make it happen, hemming and hawing about how cutting a few bucks to help hardworking Pennsylvanians, how this is gonna break the budget. We didn't hear that when folks wanted an escalator to God knows where, when it was on about EITC and OSTC. We heard nothing about how we're gonna get the money. When it was time to do tax cuts, tax credits, tax incentives for huge multinational corporations that have been making out like bandits, we never said how we're gonna get the money then. But every single time in this building, when it's time to do something for hardworking Pennsylvanians, now everybody is telling me about how we can't find the money. I just want Pennsylvanians to understand, Democrats today, we're going to vote to cut taxes, and we just passed the budget yesterday that had no tax increases. Other people voted in a different way, and that's their choice. But I think that should be noted for the record.
Representative Fritz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We seem to have engaged in a little bit of a macro conversation here, so I would like to opine this. And really, I guess, just to offer up this philosophical juxtaposition that when we talk about lowering taxes or lowering burden, in order for that to be real and honest, there would have to be a commensurate reduction in expenditures. And folks, that's not what's happening. You know, when I took my oath, along with that came a very real duty, a fiduciary responsibility to look out for this Commonwealth's financial well-being. And it is in that thought process that I have very real consternation and concerns with this package of bills. And I just think that needs to be stated aloud, that unless you reduce expenditures commensurate with the reduction in revenue, that this is not being intellectually honest. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Representative Fritz. Are any other representatives seeking recognition? Representative Mercury.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And just in one final comment in conclusion, and I do want to offer comments of support to being creative with tax cuts and making life more affordable for hardworking Pennsylvanians. But we do have to realize that taxes and spending is a math equation. Yesterday, the House approved the Democratic proposal, which was a $6 billion increase in spending. And you're right, we do have a $5 billion surplus that was contributed to and saved for years, and that's a good thing. Now, $6 billion in a one-year budget of increase does empty that savings out. And so now we're talking about a tax decrease for hardworking Pennsylvanians, which is a good thing, but in isolation. We've got to look at the whole picture at some point. And so I think this discussion is going to be important and ongoing. Thank you.
Appreciate that. Appreciate all of the comments and the discussion. And the proposal before us, House Bill 1138, the cell phone tax reduction, as I said earlier, on the balance sheet right now, about $5.5 billion a year from now, at the end of this current year. This proposal is about $64 million for the current year, and it would be a tax cut that would impact about 10 million people. I'd like to ask for a roll call vote if there's no further comments. Yes?
Yes.
Yes by designation? Yes by designation?
Yes.
Yes by designation? Yes by designation?
Yes.
Yes.
No. No by designation. No by designation. No by designation.
12 votes in favor, 9 votes opposed. The bill passes the Finance Committee. Next, I'd like to bring up House Bill 1249, sponsored by Representative Monroe and Representative Samuelson, a tax credit program for incoming nurses, teachers, and police officers. And I'd like to call on Shannon Snell, our research analyst, for a discussion. I'm sorry, and let me have a motion and a second. Moved by Representative Kenyatta. Seconded by Representative Inamorato. Shannon Snell.
Thank you. House Bill 1249 establishes a tax credit program for newly certified Pennsylvania nurses, teachers, and police officers, as well as nurses, teachers, and police officers who are certified in another state and moved to Pennsylvania.
Thank you. Is there any discussion on House Bill 1249 or perhaps I'll start it off as the co-prime sponsor. House Bill 1249 is one of the initiatives that Governor Shapiro announced in his budget proposal on March 7th. It's a recruitment and retention tax credit proposing to incentivize folks to join the professions of nursing, teaching, and police officers. My co-prime sponsor, Representative Monroe, is here in the room. And I want to put him on the spot as he's walking through the door. I'm also giving him the opportunity to have brief comments. You can see in the bill, it's a 4-page bill, talks about who would be eligible. Not only a registered nurse, but an LPN, a certified registered nurse practitioner, a clinical nurse specialist, a certified registered nurse anesthetist, and a registered nurse aide in the profession of nursing. Also for teachers, folks who get an instructional certificate, educational specialist certificate, program specialist certificate, supervisory certificate, administrative certificate, and also career and technical education instructional certificate, and career and technical education supervisory certificate, and career and technical education director certificate. And for police officers, it includes both entry-level police officers and deputy sheriffs. So we seek to have a proposal to incentivize folks. There's a lot of agencies having difficulty recruiting police officers, difficulty recruiting teachers, difficulty recruiting nurses, and a tax credit towards those individuals, we believe, would help fill some critical positions in our Commonwealth for some professions that we all depend on. I do want to call on Representative Monroe, the prime sponsor, if you'd like to offer a couple of remarks.
Thank you, chairs. Yeah, I mean, you summed it up pretty nicely. Actually, went into more detail than I was going to. So I definitely won't even go into my prepared remarks. What I will say is for those of you that don't know, I was a police officer and a police corporal for many years. You know, when I think back to my days when I was trying to become a police officer out of the academy, I was one of hundreds and hundreds of candidates that would usually vie for one or two jobs, right? And it's not like that anymore. So when you talk to police chiefs, and I know quite a few, including the ones that are in my district, they indicate that not only has it gotten bad for law enforcement, it's oftentimes now, or not only do they have fewer and fewer candidates, but they're also they're competing for a very small pool of candidates. So you have these consortium tests that they usually all try to vie for the same candidates. So it's getting pretty bad with respect. I mean, you already know about teachers. You already know about nurses. You know, I think I said the other day that that really our education system in Pennsylvania is on the verge of a crisis because of a teacher shortage. So when I spoke with my police chiefs and I spoke specifically about this bill, they do think that this would definitely be helpful. It's not going to solve the issue, obviously, overnight, but it certainly is acknowledging the shortages, and they do think it's going to help, and they are desperate for any help that we can offer. So I strongly urge and would appreciate your support.
Thank you very much, Representative Monroe. And I do want to just add one more thing, perhaps in anticipation of some of the questions. What is the fiscal impact? We got a report that says the impact for this current year, if this would pass and take effect, would be $24 million, and then in the next year, $49 million, then $73, then $49, then back to $24. This program would sunset on December 31st, 2027. So it would be a three-year tax credit for those professions. But the overall fiscal impact for this current budget year that we're talking about, $24 million. And yes, I did the math. If you take our $5.5 billion available unallocated fund balance, we're talking about 0.4% of what's in on the balance sheet as of yesterday. I'd like to open it up for questions. Representative Rader.
Broken record over here, but kind of the same question. Standing on its own, and I did want to know the fiscal impact, so thank you for that. Standing on its own, normally I would be for this bill, but it isn't standing on its own. It's standing with three or four other bills just in this committee. I don't know how many in other committees that are also going to impact our budget. And after yesterday, with a 14% vote and increase in our budget, like Rob said, Representative, it's fine for this year, but in future years, what's it gonna look like? So I don't control the budget process, but I do have to vote on bills that do impact the budget process, and I'm just a little concerned today about this package of bills just in this committee, and I don't know about other committees and other packages of bills that also impact the budget. Thank you.
Okay, Representative Fritz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So for the record, I am entirely pro-police, pro-educator, and pro-healthcare worker. But I view tax credits as being necessary only when it's a competitive response, and that begs the question for the chairman or the maker of this bill. Do other states offer this same tax credit?
Not that I'm aware of.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Representative Adams.
Thank you. I do like that it sunsets in 2027. That's a good piece. And again, I'm pro-teacher, pro-police officer as well. There are other really important positions that have likewise critical deficiencies in people. Doctors, plumbers, electricians, CDL drivers, equipment operators, children and youth caseworkers. And we sort of seem to pick and choose who's getting the tax credit and who's not, and those are pretty critical positions also. And wondering, you know, if there's opportunity, you know, why another group of people get excluded. That's, and especially children and youth caseworkers. I came from county commissioner position. There are 27 openings in Wayne County alone for county caseworkers, which require a four-year degree, by the way. So CDL drivers, school bus drivers, you name the area of employment in our Commonwealth, and everybody's struggling for labor. So I just wanted to point that out, that seems to be picking very important positions but excluding others.
Okay. I have Representative Waxman.
I would just make the comment that I think it's great to have innovative programs that attract people to Pennsylvania. And if they are different from what other people are doing in terms of tax credits or anything else, that's actually an advantage to us, not a bad thing. And so I would just urge this committee, when evaluating ideas, things that are new or that are not necessarily being modeled in every state in the country, those are the kinds of things that might be just the thing that we need to attract people to come work in Pennsylvania. So I want to just commend you for that and just urge the committee to vote yes on this bill.
And Representative Kenyatta.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would highlight that first of all, I'm sure that my colleagues do genuinely in their heart support teachers, nurses, members of law enforcement. But I will tell you, people can't pay their bills with your well wishes and with your thoughts. They get bills every month with their names on them that they need to pay. And it would be helpful if, yet again, we would be in a position to actually invest in the people who are doing the types of critical jobs that we need. Now, I would highlight that I'm going to vote for this, obviously, but I would highlight that I actually think this should go a little bit further in terms of retaining the folks in these fields that we already have. And I introduced a piece of legislation just around the teacher portion to say that for 1 year, we should do a $2,500 tax credit for folks who are already in the profession of teaching and in these other critical fields as well. Obviously, I know that this is a part of a broader tapestry of things that are going to be a part of the budget picture, but I would just highlight that in addition to recruiting new folks into these critical roles for the health, safety, and well-being of our communities, we also need to say, how can we actually keep people in these roles? I have the Philadelphia Police Headquarters is in my district, and we just did a big luncheon not too long ago with many of those folks, including the commanders and the chief of police and others. And not only is there an issue around recruitment, but there's a real issue around retention. And so I think that as we continue to advance the ball on this, I would just continue to suggest that we need to look at what we can do and what type of incentive that we can provide for keeping these folks in these critical fields here in Pennsylvania, as well as trying to bring in folks to these fields as well.
Thank you. Are there any other comments, Representative Mercury?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I commend the idea of the bill, as well as the support of our police, nurses, and teachers. Once again, I think the challenge here, and this is the Finance Committee, is the math of the budget. And yesterday, I took a vote against the proposed budget because the math doesn't work. As it stood, it did empty the rainy day fund with an increase in $6 billion of spending. And to accommodate that spending, as an example, if we were to accommodate that spending, we would need to balance the budget and raise the personal income tax in Pennsylvania by over 30%. And it is a constitutional requirement that we balance the budget. So again, I commend the idea of rewarding teachers, police officers, and nurses. We do need them. We need to figure out how to close that gap. But the budgeting math just doesn't work. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other? For the record, I'm against raising the personal income tax by 30%, which would be $4.5 billion. I just said the rainy day fund is intact. In fact, we have built it up over the last 2 years. About 2 years ago, it was $2.5 billion. And last year, we built it up to over $5 billion. This budget does not touch the rainy day fund. Still has $5 billion. In fact, there's $5.5 billion additional dollars on top of the rainy day fund that's unallocated in this budget. So I just wanted to say that, but I do know there's other comments from the committee or Chair Greiner. Any other committee members? Chair Greiner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have a couple comments and thoughts on this. It's kind of interesting. I do a little bit of tax work on the side, and was at the accounting firm. Can't hire CPAs. And the retired partner came in from the firm, and he happened to not be employed or anymore, was picking up information. He said, hey, I got to talk to you about something. So what's that? He said, what's this bill to help out nurses and what have you? He goes, I sure hope you're going to incentivize CPAs and accountants for give them a break because we can't hire people. I mean, I talked to all these accounting firms. They can't find people to do tax returns. And I kind of chuckled. I think he was being somewhat, I got his point. His point was we're picking winners and losers. That was his point. And that's a problem. I think we collectively, I've said this before, we want to talk about job creation in this Commonwealth. We got to talk about the right combination of taxes and regulatory reform and things like that. And to be able to pick winners and losers like this, I think is totally inappropriate. Just from that standpoint. Now here's a bigger issue that nobody's brought up today, surprisingly, is the constitutionality of this. And I've talked to staff about this, is that the Constitution is pretty clear. The tax credit should be because of age, disability, infirmity, poverty, or determined to be needed to the tax exemption or a special tax provision. It's a somewhat legal question. Is it constitutional? I mean, I personally don't think it is, because we are picking favorites here in the Commonwealth, and I have a problem with that. It's like I said, I've been in emergency services myself. I was a volunteer firefighter for years, and they do, whether you're paid or a volunteer, you do a great job. But I am concerned. Two things. My good colleague from Allegheny County, I think there's the financial component of this. I think it's, as my colleague from Monroe County, it's just collectively all of them together. And then for me with this bill, I think we have a serious issue with constitutionality. And I hate picking favorites. My colleague from Philadelphia talks about business stuff. Well, I don't even like picking favorites to do with that either. That's not right. We need to create an environment that gets people here, and that's just my thoughts. So because of those reasons collectively, I am going to be a no on this bill. I understand the intent. I understand the need. My dad was in the hospital, and you could see there was a need for nurses. So I get it. I mean, I really get it. But I do think in the context of the whole picture, I just think that it's something that we really need. Obviously, part of this is gamesmanship. We're positioning bills to come up with a budget. I get that. I've been here, 11 years and understand. But I really do firmly believe that for this bill, I the right vote, I mean, not emotional, but the emotional vote would be yes. But the right vote's no. And I'm voting no on this bill.
Thank you, Chair Greiner. Representative Joe Webster.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Chairman. I thought I'd kind of put this in a different context for a minute if we're talking about picking winners and losers, because that's not what we're doing. This is the government of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Public education and teachers are actually a role that we as the employers of the public education system for Pennsylvania have an interest in supporting. Nurses and police officers, just the same, right? We have a role. They will be serving public safety or public health, an interest that is prominent for the government of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. It's not the same as a commercial driver for a commercial entity. It's not the same as a CPA, which has market and all kinds of other interests that should incentivize someone to go into that career field. These are career fields that are important to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, and that's why they become part of our budget, because Pennsylvania needs teachers, police officers, and nurses. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And I appreciate Representative Monroe bringing this bill forward. I know the governor had made this a priority in his budget, saying that we need to address health care, have an incentive for nurses, education, and law enforcement. And I appreciate your experience as a law enforcement official. And I know we've had a conversation about a couple of your police chiefs in your district in Bucks County saying that this bill specifically would assist them. I do want to note that we've had other recruitment and retention bonuses. A couple years ago during the pandemic, we had in the supplemental bill, we had about $200 million for healthcare recruitment and retention. That was the overall package. And then just last year in a budget, I know the Republican leader said yesterday we had a bipartisan bill with 180 budget votes last year. In that, we had law enforcement funding, and all of our police departments have been applying for that. And many of those police departments are using those funds through PCCD. It was $135 million overall, but one of the categories that police departments have been able to apply for is a recruitment and retention bonus for law enforcement. So there has been a precedent. This is a proposal to address a critical need in healthcare, in education, in law enforcement, and respectfully ask for a yes vote. We're going to call, if there's no further comments, we're going to... I think I'm going to call the roll. Yes. Yes, by designation. Yes, by designation. Yes, by designation. Yes, by designation. Yes, by designation.
Yes.
No. No by designation. No by designation. No by designation.
Twelve in favor. Nine opposed. Just want to state for the record, there's a lot of meetings going on all at the same time, which is why we have so many folks voting by designation. The bill passes the Finance Committee, House Bill 1249, by a vote of 12 to 9. Thank you, Representative Monroe. Next, I'd like to call up Representative Chris Sappy, who has proposed House Bill 1272. In fact, I just got Representative Sappy from another meeting going on across the hall. And this would like to have a motion and a second to bring forward House Bill 1272 regarding the earned income and proposed earned income tax credit. Motion by Inamorato, Representative Inamorato. Second by Representative Kenyatta. I'd like to call on Shannon Snell for a description of the bill, and then I'll call on prime sponsor, Representative Sappy.
House Bill 1272 establishes a state-level earned income tax credit program equal to 25% of a taxpayer's federal earned income tax credit.
Thank you. I'd like to call on Representative Sappy from Chester County.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the committee for giving me a moment just to talk about this bill. I'd like to thank my colleague, Sarah Inamorato, also for doing a lot of work on this issue over the years. This An earned income tax credit is available to Pennsylvanians through the federal government currently. And Pennsylvania is one of the very few states in the region that does not offer this opportunity. And I believe strongly that this is something that we should be doing to lift up people who are doing everything right. They're working. They do not qualify for our social safety net programs, and they are frequently one car repair bill away from a serious financial situation that could actually land them back in a safety net program or derail their progress forward and, you know, their work or their career. We did a press conference with this. This legislation is actually supported by the United Way of PA and the Earned Income Tax Credit Coalition, which has 17 members that frequently support child early child care development issues, et cetera, good family programming. This legislation is really important and very much needed. And this is a really good time for us to lay this foundation and support people this year. We can take questions, we can talk about this, but I believe a lot of the information is already before you in the legislation, in the draft.
Thank you. I'd like to call on any other committee members. Representative Inamorato.
Thank you, Chairman, and I'd like to thank the prime sponsor of the bill for drafting that and bringing it to the committee. I was joined by many of my colleagues on the West on Friday when we went to visit the 211 call center run by the United Way of Southwestern PA, and we all had a moment to sit with some of the call operators. If you're not familiar with 211, that's the number you call when you don't know where else to turn for help. And in the 10 minutes that I was sitting with one of the receptionists, Ashley, who was managing the incoming calls, we heard from a single mother of five who's a bus driver who was laid off for the month because there wasn't enough work and she didn't know how she was gonna pay rent and utilities. There was a 32-year-old woman who hadn't eaten in 3 days and didn't know where she was gonna get her next meal. There was a woman who had just moved to the region and she was a single parent and didn't know how to get health insurance for her child who needed to go to have surgery in the following month. And that was just in 10 minutes. And we know there's an incredible amount of need that exists across this Commonwealth. And these are people, like the prime sponsor said, that's doing everything right. And still they're falling through the cracks. And the United Way has done an excellent job quantifying that, because I know numbers are important in a committee like finance, where they show that 39% of households in Pennsylvania are pretty much living paycheck to paycheck. And so when we look at programs like the Earned Income Tax Credit and the Child Care Tax Credit, that's targeting that population. That's recognizing as a General Assembly that we see those people and we see them doing everything right, and we want them to have more money in their pockets so that they can take care of their families in the ways that they know how. We've taken a lot of liberty in this committee in my time that I've been here to, you know, create tax credits and programs in the name of being business friendly and pro-business. And, you know, it was never about how do we pay for it. It was always about what are the positive economic ripple effects that those tax credits create. And we know that if we deploy something like an earned income tax credit and join the 31 other states in the District of Columbia that offer a state-level version, that we will see a 3-to-1 return, which means that, yes, we are foregoing revenue in this. We are investing in the people of this Commonwealth in a very direct way, but we know that there is going to be a positive economic impact that helps to bolster our public coffers and really gives us a strong return on investment from a more macro level. So, you know, this committee has been a lot. There's always been this conversation around being very pro-business. This is the opportunity to say, what if we are pro-family? What if we are pro-worker? And this is a reflection of that ideology and that vision. So I thank the prime sponsor, and I will encourage my colleagues to vote yes on this, because there are red states, there are blue states. This is a Republican initiated program from the 70s in the Ronald Reagan administration, and I think it's something that we can all come together and agree on investing in working people across this Commonwealth. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just want to add, we did get a fiscal note from the Department of Revenue this morning. The effective date listed in this bill is it's for tax years after December 31st, 2023. So the first year somebody could claim this is on their 2024 taxes, which they'll fill out, obviously, at the beginning of 2025. So with that, our Department of Revenue says the fiscal impact for the first year would be $233 million, then $377 million, then $391 million, then $405 million. So first year in 24, 25, $233 million. That's a fiscal note we got this morning. I will make sure the committee gets it, but I'm just reading it for the record. Also, I'd like to note, I know in Pennsylvania, this is a proposal that would benefit 1 million people. In Pennsylvania, there are 1 million people, if you can go right to the IRS website, 1 million people get an earned income tax credit from the federal government. Average amount, $1,800, $1,874. So this bill, as written, with 25%, those working families would be getting about $450 each. This is would be a significant tax credit to help those who need it the most. Yes, I'll put that in context of our overall fund balance, $233 million proposed for the first year. If I look at the overall fund balance unexpended at the end of June of 2024, this would be about 4% of that $5.5 billion. But we will make sure the committee gets that note from the Department of Revenue. Let me call on any other representatives who'd like to address earned income tax credit. Representative Rader.
Shockingly, yes, I want to address it. When we think about these bills individually, I'd probably be for all these bills. But collectively, once again, if that's 300 some million, we're probably talking close to $1 billion worth of revenue loss for the state. I don't know how we can legitimately do that. And we have different numbers about moving forward. I've heard your numbers about moving forward. Our caucus has a different view of our numbers moving forward. So I'm not looking just at this year. And this year, yes, I agree, probably we can pretty much spend whatever we want. But once you create these programs, they don't go away. So we have to cover the expenses of these programs in future years. And I'm looking down the line as a businessman, that's what I do, and I'm concerned about what kind of hole this puts us in and how we would get out of that hole. So yes, we can help individuals, individual groups, individual people right now, but we could hurt Pennsylvanians as a whole in the future, everyone. And how do we dig ourselves out of that? I don't know why we'd want to get ourselves in that kind of situation. So I'm not in favor of that. I'm in favor of a lot of these bills. But collectively, like I said, just today, here in our committee, it's probably close to $1 billion. What other committees are doing what? I have no idea what the budget's going to look like. So it's a concern. And I did know what passed yesterday. That was a 14% increase. That's a concern. So I'm looking not just at this year. I think because we've saved in the past, and I was part of that, we're okay this year, probably, no matter what we do. But down the line, these programs don't go away. And how are we going to pay for it? And I think we could hurt all Pennsylvanians. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Kenyatta?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I am, with all due respect to my colleague, I don't understand how supporting families who are working their butts off, still finding that they have difficulty meeting ends meet, making ends meet, I really don't understand how we hurt them by actually helping them. I mean, this is really like an upside down world that it's difficult for me to reconcile. And I will also highlight that in the budget we just passed yesterday, Democrats are talking about putting another $1.5 billion in the rainy day fund in addition to the $5 billion that's already in the rainy day fund. And so this is the proposals that you're seeing outlined, the budget discussion that we're having. None of this is about runaway spending. This is actually about saving for the future, but also investing in the very real needs of Pennsylvanians right now. And I thank the maker of the bill for bringing this forward and for continuing to put working families who need help right now first. And I would also just you know, throw this out there. You know, if we have as a committee, and it seems like there's a lot of concerns about tax credits, about fiscal responsibility, you know, Mr. Chairman, I welcome an opportunity to have a hearing about all of the tax credits that we approved in the last couple of years that maybe we should look at not having. Maybe we should get rid of some of the tax credits that we gave out to the big multinational corporations that have been able to come in here with their hand out, promise to create jobs that we never know if they actually create, and then we give them tax credits, put together proposals to try to recruit and lure them here. We should be thinking about the citizens in the same way that we think about the big corporations. How do we lure people to Pennsylvania to say this is the best place to live, to work, and to raise your family and ultimately retire? And so the next time there's a big corporation, I remember when Amazon was trying to come here and everybody was rushing to put together, how can we put together a package that they're going to love? We were rushing to do it. We need to be rushing to do that for working families. So when people think about Pennsylvania, they say, that's a place I want to be, because they take care of their own. They expand, as 31 other states have said, as my colleague pointed out, that we're moving in a direction of focusing our firepower and our efforts on supporting the working families that actually make Pennsylvania thrive the way that it should be. I look forward to voting for this bill. And as I said, Mr. Chairman, I welcome a conversation about tax credits that go to big corporations that maybe we could do without.
Any other representatives seeking recognition? Representative Mercury.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I think, you know, to add to the debate here in this committee, and it is an important discussion, because these are real families that would benefit from an earned income tax credit, and well-intentioned that it is. And I think the other side of the equation is the spending. And it's also the affordable living, or lack thereof, in the economy right now. And what we know as finance folks in this room is that when you overspend, you inflate the economy, and the cost of everything goes up. What we saw yesterday was a $6 billion increase in spending from the majority party that would require a commensurate increase in revenues. It just would. It also inflates the economy. So, you know, there's a number of ways to look at this. Everybody sitting around this table is well-intentioned, has the same goal, right? I'll admit that. We want to make lives of working families more affordable. We don't want to increase the difficulty of folks. We want to make life more affordable. How do we best do that? I think in this case, for me, we want to watch our spending. And until we see a balanced budget, it's difficult for me to vote for a decrease in revenues for the state. The math just doesn't add up. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Mercury. Any other comments on this proposal? I think Representative Greiner, Chair Greiner.
Just to close, and I brought it up before. I do think the numbers are staggering when you start talking about just the bills today. Over the next 4 years, might even be more than $1 billion with the animal. It's crazy. It's crazy math with a $6 billion increase, you know, in spending. It's so irresponsible to me what I'm looking at. You know, we can talk tax credits all we want, because I said before, I don't like picking winners and losers. I personally got trouble with tax credits. But, you know, getting back to my tax preparation, I do tax returns and I see people get special forgiveness. So we already have that already. I mean, should we be doing something rather than giving a tax credit program? Do we need to looking at our, oh, by the way, and I'll tell you what else irks me about special forgiveness. We have people that are extremely wealthy who are getting special forgiveness. And I've tried to deal with that issue here in the Commonwealth, but that's problematic as well. And it's just crazy when you see some of the people getting the breaks they are. Now, you're trying to target the right people that should get it, and I agree with that. But I guess my question is if this bill, if we already have special forgiveness, isn't this just an additional welfare program? I mean, it's simply a welfare program giving monies back. So that's the micro. But the macro is, I think it's unconstitutional. You know, and then I agree with my colleague, Representative McCurry, too. I just think financially, and Representative Rader collectively. I mean, I think it's problematic.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments, Representative Greiner. I would just say that, as I said, you look at the IRS. I'm sorry. You look at the IRS website. This is a tax credit that would benefit 1 million people in Pennsylvania. I did say the magnitude is about $233 million in the first year that we got from the Department of Revenue. I do remember not so long ago. In fact, it was last year. We had a proposal that was $1.6 billion for one single company near Pittsburgh. Now, I do realize the $1.6 billion was spread over 30 years, so it probably comes down to about $200 million a year for one company. And here we're talking about $233 million a year that would benefit 1 million people. These are working people. These are people who get a tax credit from the federal government of $1,800. Ours would be about $450, about 25% of that. 31 states have already done something. It does have a range. Montana, I think you get 2% of what you get from the federal government. There's a couple states that give you 50% of what the federal government. So it would be targeted to low to moderate income individuals. And I think that's a wise investment, and it would be broad and affect 1 million people. Sorry, Representative Greiner.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Let me just follow up on that. The one thing, we're not mixing apples with apples when we're talking about that tax credit break from the businesses last year compared to this. This, you know, and I understand the comment before that there was like 30 states or in the District of Columbia or 31 that have this. But let's not forget, though, Pennsylvania has a different type of individual tax structure that I know that we have problems with at times when we want to try to do things. And that's what makes this different. I'd love to see, you know, sometimes my colleagues on the other side, they make this argument, oh, our tax rate's only 3.07%. But here's the thing. Other states allow for itemized deductions, and they have a standard deduction, and they follow it. So it's unfair to look at that raw number is always inappropriate. A lot of states follow federal, they follow off the federal form, and it flows through to the state form. We're different here. And that's why in itself we have constitutional problem with trying to follow, take EITC following federal with state. And you're right. When you talk about, what is it, 1 in 12 people? I mean, it ends up being real money, you know, doing that. But I'm just saying, you know, it's worth having the discussion to see what we can do to give people a hand up, you know, which I think is what you're trying to do. But I'm saying I don't think this is the methodology or this is the way to do it. And I do think there's legal questions with this. And I do think in the context of all these bills together, and like I said, I understand what's going on. We're putting bills in you know, to do a budget negotiation, and that's fine. I get that. But I'm just bringing to light, though, that there are problems beyond just what, you know, we have our differences with finances. There's no question. The parties think differently. But I do believe there's a legal question here too, and I just wanted to bring that in. And I do think, and I understand what you're saying about the break or the tax credits we gave to get the business here, but that's a different mechanism, and it wasn't directly on personal income tax. So I just wanted to make that clarification. So, and by the way, I still don't like picking winners and losers, whether it's corporations either. I'm just making that comment.
Okay. You know. Well, thank you, Representative Greiner. Appreciate all the comments today. I appreciate Representative Sappy putting this bill forward. I appreciate Representative Inamorato and all her work on this issue over the years. And thank you for all of the comments. I know one of my colleagues said we wish we had a balanced budget in front of us before we vote on anything. However, if that were the case, that means we'd be delegating passing that balanced budget to Governor Shapiro in the state Senate, and we would just be sitting on the sidelines waiting for them to come up with that balanced budget. We're not going to do that. We're trying to be proactive. We are putting some proposals forward. I realize there are 24 days of budget negotiations ahead of us. We're putting some proposals forward that could benefit working Pennsylvanians and can benefit Pennsylvanians. If there's no other comment, so I will call a vote on House Bill 1272. We had an amendment considered, but it was not offered. So just a roll call on the House Bill 1272. Yes? Vote by designation. Vote by designation, yes. And
Gallagher?
Vote by designation, yes. Vote by designation, yes. Vote by designation, yes.
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 And I should have said, Representative Deloso is a vote by designation, yes.
No. No by designation. No by designation. No by designation.
Twelve votes in favor, nine votes opposed. House Bill 1272 passes the Finance Committee. Now we have one more bill on our agenda. We have House Bill 1259. We had a public hearing about House Bill 1259, Child Care Tax Credits, yesterday. And I'd like to ask for a motion to bring that bill forward. Representative Kenyatta moves. Representative Webster seconds. House Bill 1259 is before the committee. I'd like to ask Shannon Snell to provide a summary of the bill.
House Bill 1259 expands the existing Child and Dependent Care Tax Credit Program.
Thank you, and I appreciate the folks who were here yesterday testifying. In fact, we have Laura Mannion from the Chester County Chamber of Business and Industry, the president and CEO, with us today, and appreciate your testimony that you gave us yesterday. And the prime sponsors, Representative Tina Davis and Representative Melissa Schusterman, provided remarks yesterday on this bill. So last year in the budget, we provided a tax credit for child and dependent care expenses. The language in the budget that last year, last July 8th, that was put forward, based it on the federal amount. And when you do your federal taxes, you fill out IRS Form 2441 to get your child and dependent care tax credit. And then it's based on a percentage of the amount that you get. And then the way the language was written last year, our state tax credit was a percentage of that percentage. So I think it worked out to about 30% of the 30% you get at the federal level. So you know that the average amounts that folks were getting with a single child this current tax year, about $300 for folks with incomes under $43,000, and at higher incomes above $43,000, the average tax credit was $180. This proposal before us from Representative Davis and Representative Schusterman talks about giving the tax credit as a percentage of the amount that is claimed on the of child care expenses. So that would be a larger tax credit. About 220,000 people qualified in Pennsylvania last year. Oh, I'm sorry, for the current tax year that people are filling out their taxes this year. I know the Department of Revenue is trying to put out the awareness about this. Other states have done this. But basing it on 30% of your expenses would be a larger tax credit in year one in this proposal. 30%, but it also escalates it 35% in year two, 40%, then 45%, then 50% by the year. I believe it's by tax year 2028, it would be up to a 50% tax credit. 2027, before January 1st, 2028. I know the bill we referred to the other committee, the Children and Youth Committee this morning, talked about a 50% tax credit for businesses. When we look at child care expenses, there's a need. It's an expensive item for many, many families all across our Pennsylvania. The testimony, I know Laura's here, Laura Mannion from Chester County. My goodness, the statistics that she provided us, that families are spending $15,000 for one child, $30,000 for two children. I'm sure they appreciate that $180 they got from Pennsylvania last year, but we need to expand it. We need to expand it, expand the base like the bill would do, and then we need to step that up. The other bill, a comprehensive solution, would involve business tax credits. The other bill actually talked about a 50% tax credit for business. This bill ramps it up from 30 to 50. Sorry to go into all that detail, but I'd now like to open it up for questions. Representative Adams and Rader, Adams first. We'll start with, out of tradition, we're going to start with Representative Jack Rader.
Thank you. I'll try and make mine quick. Do we have any estimate of how much money revenue it would take out of our coffers, the budget?
I'm awaiting an official estimate from the Department of Revenue. I do not have that at this moment.
Do you have any kind of guesstimate, or you don't want to do
well,
that?
Well, last year in the budget, when the tax code passed last July 8th, we had an estimate for what the current proposal cost.
But you know what? I won't ask you to do that. That's not fair.
I think it was about $41 million. Obviously, if we're increasing the base, it would be higher this year. And then as it ramps up to 2028, it would be higher.
Of course, my comment would be.
So I know I anticipate your comment. I wish I had that that estimate from the Department of Revenue. I do not, but if I extrapolate from last year's.
Thank you.
It would be in the. I will get that as soon as I get it from Department of Revenue.
Great. Thank you.
Representative Adams.
Great. Thank you very much. So if my math is correct, not counting this math for today, just today, this committee just approved a little more than $2 billion of revenue reductions over the next 4 years. And we all like to see that. We all like to see tax reductions and fee reductions. But as many colleagues stated today, we also need to offset that with expense cuts, and we certainly haven't done that. We're spending on reoccurring expenses using one-time revenue sources, and that's a recipe for disaster. Which, oh, by the way, the surpluses, for the most part, came from one-time revenue sources, federal CARES and ARPA money over the last few years. So, you know, the rainy day fund and the fund balance grew dramatically over the last couple of years, primarily due to federal CARES and ARPA money. So this is like paying for groceries using your savings account and paying for all your household items using your savings account. And then when the savings account's gone 4 or 5 years from now, how do you sustain your household? My question specifically for this bill is, based on what was in the bill and the appropriations department of the caucus put out that in the year five, somebody who makes $307,000 a year is going to get a 100% tax reduction to zero from the state on their state Pennsylvania income taxes. I'm not sure that that's the intent of what we're trying to do, but that's one of the unintended consequences of the way the language in this bill is written. So if you scroll up to 50% and you have $10,000 of expenditure based on that 50%, which again, there's only $20,000 total in childcare costs. You make a $307,000 a year in the state of Pennsylvania, you're not going to pay any income tax based on this. And, you know, certainly we all understand and we want to provide for families who have great needs and want to go to work and have high expenses. But I don't know that somebody who makes $307,000 a year has nearly as great a need as somebody who's making 50, 60, 100. So I just wanted to point that out, and that's concerning. But, you know, $2 billion of revenue reductions without any expenditure reductions will eat our fund balance and our rainy day fund up really quickly. And then where are we after that? So those are
Thank you, Representative Adams. Are there any other comments? I know we have about 7 minutes to get to the House floor. I'm going to call on Representative Griner. Does anybody want to speak before Representative Griner? Representative Kenyatta, and we have about 7 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just very, very briefly, I was trying to find the exact date here, but last year in October, there was a $2 billion tax credit proposal that the House passed. You know, it just feels like a lot of my colleagues, and I know that it's been a lot of turnover in this building, but, you know, folks tend to forget the tax credits that we just did a lot of them last year. The only difference here is who's getting the money. We want to give the tax credits to working Pennsylvanians, and for a long time in this building, the tax credits went to big corporations. And so that's really the only difference here that I would highlight. But again, I mean this genuinely, if there are tax credits that folks want to get rid of for huge corporations, if folks want to talk about the wealthiest Pennsylvanians paying their fair share, like literally sign me up for that. We can get some bipartisan votes going quickly.
Thank you, Representative Kenyatta. I'm going to call on Chair Griner.
I know we have to get up on the House floor. Just real quickly, I do agree. I'm not quite sure this bill's crafted the way it should be. The makers yesterday were talking about an incremental increase in the tax credit. What they thought the bill was yesterday in that hearing is not with the way the bill's written. And it's clear that there was a section taken out from the bill as per last session. So I am worried about the intent. It is irresponsible that you have a union worker making $90,000 with no kids, gets dinged with state taxes, yet you have a couple making $300,000 with two kids with childcare for $20,000 or $30,000, and they don't pay any income tax in the state. That's the way this bill looks like it's written, and the way we interpret it in its current form, it's real money. It's hundreds of millions of dollars per year, for according to our Appropriations Committee, looking at the analysis. So because of that, it's just out of bounds. It's overboards. I understand the intent. I still think there's a constitutionality issue, even with the current law. That's my thoughts. So I just wanted to make that clear. We think the bill is not, it's either not crafted in the right way or drafted, because we're not hearing that the numbers are, you know, we heard, you know, $180, $500. All of a sudden, we're talking credits of $10,000. That's wrong in my estimation, and I'm going to be a definite no on this bill.
Thank you, Representative Griner. We're seeking to increase the existing program we have for child and dependent care tax credits. And I ask our legislative assistant to call the roll in the next 3.5 minutes. Yes. Designation, 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 yes.
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 No. No by designation. No by designation. No by designation. No by designation.
Thank you. House Bill 1259 passes the Finance Committee, 12 in favor, 9 opposed. Thank you all for attending today. This meeting of the House Finance Committee is adjourned.